Good morning. And grace and peace to you. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We welcome you to our worship service here at 6 and 6. Special welcome to any guests or visitors who might be with us today. We'd encourage you, as well as everyone, to sign in on the registration cards that are in the pews. Also like to welcome you to stay for a time of coffee and fellowship following the worship service today. I do have a couple of announcements to draw your attention to. One is because of the coronavirus, we're not going to be doing any time of fellowship or passing of the peace. We're going to be skipping that part. And basically, we're going to be treating this just like if there was a bad outbreak of influenza A. So be smart about washing your hands, using the hand sanitizer. There's also in the back of the church, I received something from the Center for Disease Control, just some precautionary recommendations. It's a white sheet in the middle of the table in the back. If you are interested in that, you can pick that up when you leave. Also, we were showing the movie tonight. I'm not sure if we're going to have screens up or not. Do we? Okay. Well, let me do some other announcements to give you a chance. Also, there's a Maundy Thursday insert in your bulletin, so if you'd like to help out with that, donations are appreciated for soup and bread. Also, there's an invitation to sign up for Fishes and Loaves. I saw that out on the fellowship hall. There's hardly anybody signed up for that, so if you could help with that, that would be great. Also, family night out, we're planning on meeting this week, and we'll also as a sign-up sheet for that as well. And what we'll be doing for adults at 6:30 is watching the second half of Rabbi Zacharias that's on the death of truth and decline of culture. So, Brad, are we ready with that? We've got the video trailer for that movie.
Car was speeding.
No, please don't let me kill my partner.
Why don't you, man? Just put us both out of our misery.
You got in trouble again, didn't you?
We'll talk about this.
No, we'll talk about it now.
Blake.
Something going on at home?
Don't go preacher on me, man.
I'm not going preacher. I'm your friend.
I am alone. Been alone since I buried my first boy. Doesn't matter anymore.
I feel like I'm failing at what I was put on this earth to do. I want to make a difference, like you did.
You never underestimate the power of grace.
Movement! Please, please!
We need an ambulance!
Miss McDonald?
I'm sick about the man's family. I was called to minister to people. That's what Mac's doing in my life, Deborah. Showing me what my heart really is. So
you thought you just answer me this, Sam. What is there to believe in, man?
You know we in this together, Mac. You do, so we
think that you're good. I promise to pray for you every day, ask your forgiveness, grant you the same, and be your friend always.
That is the grace card.
Written silent starts with forgiveness. That's the only thing that makes a difference.
I'm so sorry. Please tell me you forgive me.
It's not justice we need. It's grace.
The Grace Card.
That will be tonight at 6:30. Bring your own drink. Popcorn will be furnished. And then also notice in the bulletin, we're going to be doing the installation of the new ceiling tile on March 21st on Saturday at 9 a.m. If you'd like to help with that project, please show up. And also there is a piano in the old basement that we're offering free. So if you like this piano, it's not a big upright, it's the smaller one, but it's free, but we want you to have to pick it up and remove it. So it's yours if you want it. Also announced that there's a birth this last week. With joy, we announced the birth of Zion, and I think it's pronounced Wong Zhao Ernst, born to Tyler and Joyce Ernst of Bellevue, Washington on March 11. Zion weighed 9 pounds, 2 ounces, and 21 inches long. The proud grandparents and great-grandmother from our church family are Brian and Sonia Ernst and Irma Winter. For prayer concerns, want to pray for continued prayers for Karen Kintop. She's in church today, but she had surgery on her foot this week and seems to be healing and doing well, so continue to pray for her. Also, an update on Esther. Esther had some plastic surgery done on her back from the wound she had before. It was not healing properly. And I found out from her this morning that she's kind of running a fever, but they think it's because of the medication she's on. So we want to pray that they can get that adjusted and that her wound will heal properly for her. And then also another update was for Sandra Jensen. We had hoped that she wouldn't have to do any radiation or chemo, but they're wanting to start chemo, and she's having a port put in this week, and then we'll start chemo after that. So we want to pray for that chemo to eradicate all the cancer that is present. So continue to pray for them as well. Those are the updates that I have at this time. Any other joys or concerns? All right, and we're not going to greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ. You can just shout that across the hall if you want, but we're gonna then go and have you stand for the call to worship. Oh, wait, we'll sing the song, Change My Heart, O God. It's my heart, O God.
Please join me in the call to worship. Cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let you fall.
But you, O God, will bring down the wicked into the pit of corruption.
Bloodthirsty and deceitful men will not live out half their days.
But as for me, I trust in you. Come, let us worship the Lord our God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear us in the name of Jesus Christ. You have taught us in your word not to forget worshiping together. We come this morning meeting in your presence, dependent on your promises, and we ask that you might pardon our offenses, remove any ill feelings we may have towards one another, that in seeking you, we might find you and be able to worship you in the spirit and truth in all we say and do this morning. Amen. Our opening hymn is Standing on the Promises, words on the screen, number 271.
Thank you.
Please join me in the unison prayer of confession. Holy and loving God, anger is often our weak spot. It fuels our resentments. It could prevent us from letting go. It fuels our self-righteousness. We cling to anger as if it could save us, hoping it will protect us from pain and loss. But it is folly. Salvation is trusting in you to make things right. Hope is found in keeping our eyes on you and all you have done to us, rather than others and how they have let us down. Forgive our short-sighted and self-inflicted foolishness, Lord. Restore us in love and grace to us in all things do. Amen.
Almighty God, our Father, is merciful and he is gracious. He is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. And our Lord sent his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross. And it is by his wounds that we are saved. Friends, believe in the good news. For in the name of Jesus Christ, we truly are forgiven. Amen. At this time, we have a minute for mission, and Bill's going to be talking a little bit about the lilies on the cross, or for the cross, I should say.
Well, good morning. Glad to see everyone here. You know, about 2007, when Frank and Sue Lou moved, and Dale and Jan Eads were all part doing this Easter lily cross, and my wife said she wanted to do that, and I said, well, I'm not going to do it. She said, yes, you are, and I said, no, I'm not. She said, yes, you are. So we've been doing this now for about 13 years. So anyway, going through the years, everybody's bringing Easter lilies, and some of them are from different places. The foil backing that's on the pots are different. So we wanted to try to make it so it's all unified, have the same color. And it says in the bulletin we need at least 12. 15 is nicer, but 12 is the minimum. So anyway, so my wife said to me, she said, somebody needs to get up and talk about that. And I said, I'm not doing it. She said, yes, you are. I said, no, I'm not. She said, yes, you are. And I said, no, I'm not. So I'm up here now telling you what we need to do. So anyway, what we'd like to have you do is when you order, you know, put it on the form there. It'll make things a lot easier. It's always beautiful to have that on Easter Sunday. So we just encourage everyone to be involved and help us out with that. And before I get off here, you guys have noticed in the bulletin that we're behind on the general fund. And it's starting to get to bother, you know, people that are on the property finance in the session. And my wife said, somebody needs to get up there and talk about it. And I said, I'm not doing it. She said, yes, you are. I said, no, I'm not. So I'm up here to talk to you a little bit about that. Anyway, just think about the reasons that we give, the thankfulness that by living in the country that we have, being on the property finance, I feel terrible for them. And the reason I thought it's worthwhile mentioning, this week I got a disturbing email that now we think we have to use the property needs offering the end of the month to help us with the general fund. And being on the session, I hate seeing that we're using funds just for another purpose to help us with the general fund. So then I started thinking, well, why are we giving? You know, why do we give? I learned a valuable lesson when I was 49 years old. I was taking over my folks as all their financial stuff because they couldn't do it anymore. And we were at the lawyer's office and we were getting ready to sign. And I said, Dad, do you have any other questions or what you'd like to do? And he said, I got one last question. I said, what? He said, will you make sure that you give to the church? And they were members of the church in Spirit Lake. Would you make sure that you give what I want to give for my offering every week? I said, yep, I'll make sure you do it. And he said, okay, I'll sign it. He said, even though that I'm not there, I feel like I want to contribute. I'm still part of that family, They've been good for me. But he said, mostly I want to thank God for everything he's done for me. He's blessed me. You know, he's blessed me through a lot of things. So, like, when we're thinking about what we're doing, are we giving out of duty because we have to, or are we giving out of thankfulness, out of joy for what we've been given? You know, thankful for grace, thankful for mercy. You know, thank you for parents, you know, learning from them. But thank you for all the things that we've done. And at the end of the month, we're going to have a special offering to try to balance this thing out. So prayerfully consider what you can do on the end of the month so we can get ahead of this. This is a problem all over the country. Every church that I talk to, they're all having financial problems. Well, is this, you know, coronavirus thing going to be any worse? Is it going to make it worse for all of us? I don't know. But I sure am going to put my faith in the Lord. I'm not going to turn tail and put my faith in the government and everything else they say they're going to do for us. My faith is in the Lord. So I think the only way he can bless us is if we are thankful for what he's done for us. So prayerfully consider it. Thanks a lot. And my wife says I got to get off now, so I'm coming
back. Thank you, Bill. At this time, we're going to have some special music. Claire Vreeman is going to be playing. She's the daughter of Jason and Katie Vreeman, and would be the great-great-great-granddaughter of Ruby Jansen. So. Thank you, Claire. At this time, we're going to have a 125th announcement, which we're probably going to be doing over the next several weeks. So I would invite those who are doing that to come forward at this time.
Candy.
Hi, Carrie.
What are you doing?
I'm looking at my new family album that I just got.
Family album? What are you talking about? Let me see that.
I'll show you.
They're not in your family.
not your family. Of course it is. It's my church family.
There you go. That's right.
So, this is your church family?
My church family, yeah.
So, what exactly are you looking at here?
Well, it's the directory here. Back in August and November, we had people come and get their pictures taken. So, it's in this nice little album here, and there's a little bit of scrapbook pages in the front. And then in the back is people's addresses and phone numbers.
Well, that's really cool. I don't have a family album like that of my own family, with their addresses and all their pictures and the fun things that are going on at church. So why did we make this church directory?
Because it's cool.
It's cool, but what's happening in June, Danny?
We're celebrating 125 years.
125 years of this beautiful family that we have here at First Presbyterian. So, if you had your photo taken for our directory, that is complimentary to you. And how do they get those, Candy?
Next week, I will be sitting at a table, and you may come and pick up your directory.
So, if you're not in our directory and you're still part of our church family, can you get a family album of our church?
Yes, we do have a few extra. There will just be a minimal fee, and I will have those extras also. So,
now, I can be honest. I have flipped through that. A good-looking bunch here, so very good-looking. Very proud of our church and all the hard work that's gone into planning for the 125th. Mark your calendars now. So that weekend is very special to our church, and it's very special to us and all of you as part of our family. So look forward to getting your books and looking at all these good-looking people in here. So thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah.
For today, we're going to skip the time for children, so we'll move to our Old Testament reading.
Our Old Testament reading is Exodus 20, verse 13, found in your NIV Bible, page 118, NIV Children's Bible, page 87, the sixth commandment, thou shall not kill. Please join me in the unison reading of the Ten Commandments. Words on the screen. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make any graven image and not bow down to them, nor serve them. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Keep the Sabbath day to sanctify it, as the Lord thy God hath commanded thee. Honor thy father and thy mother. Thou shalt not kill, neither shalt thou steal, neither shalt thou bear false witness against thy neighbor, neither shalt thou desire thy neighbor's wife, neither shalt thou covet thy neighbor's house, his field, his manservant, or his maidservant, his ox, or his ass, or anything that is thy neighbor's. Our hymn of preparation is Trust and Obey, words on the screen, number 349.
Let us stand.
Thank you.
Will you please remain standing for our gospel reading? Reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 21 through verse 22a. Hear now the word of our Lord. Jesus said, "You had heard that it was said to people long ago, 'Do not murder,' and 'Anyone who murders will be subject to judgment.' But I tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment." The word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Melt us, mold us, fill us, use us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Amen. On this third Sunday of Lent, we will continue our series of "By His Wounds We Are Healed." And if you hadn't noticed in the back, Pastor Maggie completed the Lenten chalk drawing of that same title, "By His Wounds We Are Healed." And if you get a chance, take a look at it. It's an excellent chalk drawing. And unfortunately, Jesus suffered the penalty of death for all the commandments that we have broken. And on Ash Wednesday, we looked at first the wounds of blasphemy when we worship other gods and when we take the Lord, our God's name, in vain. That was followed by the next week, we looked at wounds that we commit by violating the Sabbath. And last week, we looked at the wounds of dishonoring authority or not honoring our mother or our father and mother. And today we're going to look at the sixth commandment, which is the wounds of murder. You shall not murder. Now, on this particular Sunday, it's rather ironic when we are considering the subject of murder that the coronavirus is killing people all over the world. Even in rural Sibley, the coronavirus pandemic has hit our stores. The grocery store, the dollar store, the last couple of days have run out of toilet paper and hand sanitizer as people were grabbing as much as they could off the shelves. But you must know that the sixth commandment is not about a virus that kills. Rather, it's about something we humans do to each other. But it would be breaking the sixth commandment if you happened to be aware or knew that you had the coronavirus and you were spreading it around to other people. That would be considered breaking the commandment. Even so, I would venture to say, of all the commandments, this is one where probably say, well, that's not one we will ever break. You don't worry about that. I mean, who would go around and murder anyone that comes to church? I mean, you're a Christian. You don't do those sort of things. But nevertheless, murder has got to be one of the gravest sins a person can commit. In fact, some people view murder as the standard, kind of the golden standard, and sometimes they even use the excuse for like a lesser sin by saying, well, at least I haven't murdered someone. And maybe you've heard that before. Maybe your kids have even said that. You know, you didn't break that commandment. But murder of another human being is a serious matter for us, mainly because we are created in God's image. And we were made to live in harmony with one another and with God as well as our fellow man. That harmony, though, became broken once sin entered the world. And that takes us back to the fact that murder is one of the first sins that was committed in that when Cain murdered Abel, and you know that they were the first children that were born into the world to Adam and Eve, who also actually broke a command when they ate off the tree that was forbidden. They were wanting to be like God, in a sense, kind of worshiping, wanting to worship something other than God. And so as we look at this sixth commandment, we need first to look at what it doesn't mean, and then we'll look at what is the translation of it, what does it apply to, and then we'll have some practical applications. Now, this is one of the shortest commandments. There is a shorter verse in the Bible. I think people probably know what that is. Anybody know what the shortest verse in the Bible is? That's correct. This is close. This is only four words. Thou shalt not murder. So, often though, this commandment is twisted to mean something that it was not intended to. Such as, thou shalt not murder is not talking about killing animals, as some activists, vegetarian activists especially, would like us to believe. So we shouldn't eat any meat at all. But I'm not sure if they realize that after the flood, God made it clear to Noah in Genesis 9:3 that he said, every moving thing that lives and moves is going to be food for you. I am now giving you everything. So I would say, don't become a vegetarian based on this commandment. One also does not commit murder if it is in self-defense. According to the Bible, if someone is breaking into your home and threatening your life and it happens that you kill them, the Bible says a murder has not been committed. Exodus 22:2, just a little later than where we have the Ten Commandments, says, if a thief is found breaking in and is struck so that he dies, the defender is not guilty of bloodshed. But if it happens after sunrise, after the sun is up, he is guilty of murder. So that doesn't mean, though, that you should post a sign like this in the front of in your front yard. But truth be told, though, when you outlaw law-abiding citizens from being able to defend themselves, the only people that have guns are the outlaws. Murder also does not apply to war. It seems that war protesters are always quoting the Sixth Commandment, and you might be able to guess the time frame of this by looking at the their length of their hair and the way they were dressed. I believe these are people protesting the war in Vietnam, as many were at that time. Rightly so, though, war, when it takes place, some of the killing is wrong. But the Sixth Commandment has more to do with the private morality and not the situation of war. The Minutemen of 1775, this is a rock that's engraved representing them, has got it right concerning war. They said, don't, you maybe can't read it, but it says, don't fire unless fired upon, and if they mean war, let it begin here. And when it comes to war, we must extend the principles of self-defense found in the Bible. For Solomon tells us in Ecclesiastes 3:8, there is a time for war and a time for peace. It is wrong, though, for a nation to unjustly attack another nation. But it is not wrong for us to protect our family, to protect our country, and to protect our land. What is considered murder, then? Well, King David, a man who was after God's own heart, was considered a fearless warrior. He had slain, we don't know how many, but hundreds, if not thousands, of men on the battlefield. And Scripture tells it that it is clear that God was with him in those encounters. But when David killed a single innocent man, Uriah the Hittite, who was Bathsheba's husband, and Bathsheba was the one he lusted after, God was gravely disappointed in what David did. And the judgment that was brought down upon David was death. It was the death of the son that was born then to Bathsheba and David. So it is murder when we intentionally kill someone. And David was guilty of murder, even though he himself did not shoot the arrows. But what he did was he purposely had Uriah placed in the front lines where he would be most likely to get shot at. Also, every year in America, some 400,000 people make an attempt to take their own life. And out of those 400,000, 30,000 are successful, and about 5,000 are teenagers. And even though for some they see no way out, taking your own life is prematurely is wrong. It's also wrong to take a life if it's an act of mercy, say in euthanasia. But both are the wrongful ending of an innocent life. No one has the right to take their own life. Why? Because we are not our own. We were bought with a price. We belong to God, who has given us life, and God will be the one who will determine when our life will end. The problem with suicide is that it also does not end all the pain, for often the family is left to have to pick up all the pieces, and sometimes it's years upon years of sorrowfulness that they have to deal with. Another way we're guilty of murder is concerning the subject of infanticide or abortion. If the definition of murder is intentionally killing someone who is innocent, well then by that definition, abortion has killed tens of millions of innocent lives since 1973, which works out to around 1 million a year and 3,000 every day, or 2 deaths every minute. In Psalm 139:13, it says, "For you created my inmost being, and you knit me together in my mother's womb." And so a life that God creates is not one that we should willingly destroy. There are, however, other ways for us to murder someone. Jesus, in his Sermon on the Mount, expanded the sixth commandment. He actually stretched this quite a bit. He said, "You have heard it said that people long ago said, 'Do not murder.' And anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But he says, 'I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother will be subject to judgment.'" And this is where we should all probably start squirming in our seats, because all of a sudden, this commandment that we thought didn't involve us now makes us all a little bit uncomfortable. Jesus knew that the emotion of anger is what often causes us to take another human's life. So if you've ever wished for someone to be dead, or if you've even ever really hated someone and hated what they did, hated everything they stood for, Jesus is saying you're guilty of murder. And now I think that makes just about all of us guilty of breaking the sixth commandment. There's probably times when we've really hated what someone else had done or did to us. And anger and hatred of another human being is something we must always avoid, for it almost always leads us to either say or do something that we later regret, whether it's something we've said or did to someone who we had an ill feeling for. Now, just in case we might think we're still innocent of the sixth commandment, there are even more ways that we can kill someone. We're guilty of killing when we destroy or take away a person's dream. We're also guilty of killing when we kill their spirit by taking away their joy or their ambition. And we can do this by our words or our actions. And so there's so many different ways we can do that today, and the many different ways we can communicate. Literally, though, thousands of lives are affected by things we may post that are half-truths about another person just to tear them down or to try and make them feel bad. And ECO, when they put and formed the Covenant Order of Evangelical Presbyterians, they put together something called the Essential Tenets of Faith. They were the essentials that they believed that we needed to hold up and affirm that were not going to be removed. These were the things we wanted to hold on to that were solid. And in the last part, the last section, it talks about living in obedience to the Word of God. They listed the Ten Commandments, although they didn't call them the Ten Commandments. There are actually 10 of them, and they're all the commandments sort of rewritten for us today. And concerning the sixth commandment then, I realized when I was doing a new Covenant Partners class this week that as we were going over these essentials, I remembered the rewriting of the Ten Commandments, and I thought, okay, we need to look at this, because on the sixth commandment, they actually played off Jesus' extension of anger by saying, eradicate the spirit of anger, resentment, callousness, violence, or bitterness, and instead cultivate a spirit of gentleness, of kindness, of peace, and joy, and love. And recognize and honor the image of God in every human being from conception to natural death. This document spells out what anger is, and biblically what should replace it, which basically are the fruits of the Spirit. And that all life, notice they've also reflected on the importance of human life that has been created by God. That all life, from the moment of conception to natural death, should be honored, protected, lifted up as sacred, and considered holy creations of God. So as we go forward, I want us to consider, what do these three great men of the Bible have in common? What does Moses, David, and Paul all have in common? And you may not, I think once I say this, you'll catch that. They were all murderers. They all killed people. And yet, they were saved. They were forgiven. And they're in heaven today. Now, that's good news for us, because the sin of murder is still alive and well in our society today. It lurks deep within each of us in our own hearts, especially when we show anger towards others. And when it comes right down to it, I'd venture to say we're all guilty of breaking this sixth commandment. But the wounds of Jesus, the wounds of his death, make it possible for us all, no matter what you have done in your past, to receive love, to receive reconciliation, and to receive forgiveness and everlasting peace. This is especially important for us, like right now, when we're facing uncertain times with the coronavirus. We need to learn to exchange whatever problems we're facing in this world with the promises of God's holy word that have stand the truth of time, that are the same yesterday, are the same today, and will be the same in the future for as well. We need to replace our fear, our doubt, our worry. We need to replace that with our faith. And if we would only see the world through the message of the cross, we would have nothing to fear but fear itself. And because of the wounds of Christ, we have forgiveness, and we have the promise of everlasting life that has been offered to us. And we need to remember that nothing, I mean nothing, can take that from us, not even the coronavirus. Because God has set before us that he will never leave us nor forsake us. And no matter what we are going through in our lives, God will be there for us. Amen. At this time, I'd like to go to the time of prayer, and want to note that our president, President Trump, declared that today, March 15, should be a national day of prayer. As we pray about the coronavirus and about the health and welfare of our nation, so let us pray. O God, our Father, as we come to you in prayer this morning, we offer you thanks that you are always present to us, even though there are times when we are not present with you. And so we come this morning giving thanks for the love that you have for us, and that you love the world so much that you gave us your one and only Son, Jesus Christ. His death and resurrection has made it possible for us to be forgiven of our sins and to receive eternal life. And we come, O Lord, this morning seeking a good word from you, especially as the pandemic of the coronavirus has created confusion and fear among us. And for many, it is the fear of the unknown, as it is a disease we've never had to deal with before. But you, O Lord, tell us in Psalm 41, 10 through 11, from the Message, that we should not panic, for you are with us. and that there is no need to fear, for you are our God, and you will give us strength. And you promise to help us and hold us steady by keeping a firm grip on us. Help us to hold these words close to our hearts, that whenever we feel a sense of fear or doubt or worry, that we would replace it with our faith in you. We pray this morning that the coronavirus would slow down and die out. We pray also that you would protect as many people as possible who might be suffering from the consequences of the virus. And help us, O Lord, to be smart about containment, that we might follow good practices of prevention. May we use this as a way to be the church, to be the church as a shining light, to be a rock in the middle of shifting sand all around us. And so we come this morning praying for our families who are gathered here. We ask that you would, your healing presence be with those who are ill, those who are homebound, those who mourn with a sorrow too deep for words. And so we lift up first those on our prayer chain of concerns. We pray for Karen Kintop and give thanks for a successful surgery, and also for Jasmine Thompson, who recovers from her surgery, and for success of that and good healing. We want to pray for Esther Ernst, who went in this past Thursday evening to have plastic surgery to repair her past surgery on her back. We pray that, Lord, that will heal. We also pray that the fever she's now experiencing will be the results of too much, too strong of a pain medication, and that, Lord, that she could be healed and move beyond all these difficulties that she has been facing. We also pray for Sandra Jensen as she begins to take chemo. We'll have a port this week and start the next week, and we pray that that chemo would just eradicate any cancer that might be there, and we just pray for no bad side effects as well. We pray for Mackenzie Ryder, who's dealing with severe headache aches, just for her as she waits. Also for Novina Popkes, that for the strength that she can continue to have as she started her chemo treatments. We pray for Violet Byers, who's doing chemo treatment, and we just pray that they can regulate any of the side effects for her, as well as for Ruth Jurens, who's facing her cancer as well. We pray for all those families who have lost loved ones. We pray for the family of Marge Uzo, who passed away. Also for Pam and Todd Juber, the loss of Todd's parents, Harvey and Pat. For the family of Ruth Krall, and for Mary Cruz and her family in the passing of her brother-in-law. For Alvin Cruz and the family of Raleigh Munkemeyer, and for Marie Shuck's family as well. We also pray for our president and for the nation, especially in this time of pandemonium. And we pray for all those around the world who are being affected by this disease. And, O Lord our God, as we look to this next week of uncertainty, may we remember that Jesus warned us that we would expect trouble in the days ahead. He never said that our lives would be perfect and there would be no pain and discomfort. But he also promised that he would never leave us nor forsake us. So as a church, O Lord, when the world around us gets darker, help us to make this opportunity to shine brighter for you. And may we remember what Paul told us in 2 Timothy, that God does not give up on us, and he did not give us a spirit of fear or timidity, but a spirit of power and love and self-discipline. And so we come before you this morning lifting up all of these thoughts and prayers. And Lord, may we stand firm in faith, holding up the light of your word that stands forever and ever. And now let us pray that prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those and patient, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we'll stand for our closing, we'll have our offering. The verse for that is from the Message from Luke 12, 33 through 34, which says, Be generous, give to the poor, Get yourselves a bank that can't go bankrupt, a bank in heaven, far from bank robbers, safe from embezzlers, a bank you can count on. It's obvious, isn't it? The place where your treasure is the place that you will most want to be and end up being. Let us pray. O God, our Father, we do thank you for the privilege of being able to give, without which our lives would be impoverished indeed. We pray this morning for grace to give well, to help without patronizing, to assist without weakening, and to share without diminishing the self-respect of others. Bless now the gifts we lay before you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And our closing hymn is Great is Thy Faithfulness, number 43, or words will be on the screen.
Thank you.
Before I give the benediction, I just want to let you know that Dawn and I are going to be driving to Albuquerque. We're not flying. So we're going to be as safe as we can. We're going to bring gloves and a lot of wipes. So we're going to be as safe as we can. So receive now the benediction of our Lord. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and may the peace of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. And I'm also going to be doing fist bumps instead of shaking your hands afterwards, too. So, okay.